It's a new dawn for women in Morocco. The introduction of a law years in the making criminalizing sexual violence and harassment. It follows growing concern in recent years in the country about the levels of abuse against women. One recent survey found that 6 in 10 Moroccan women had suffered some kind of violence. The law criminalizes forced marriage, cyber harassment, and sexual harassment in public places. It also increases penalties for some forms of violence in the penal code when committed within the family. Those found guilty of violating the law face prison terms ranging from 1 month to 5 years and fines from $200 to $1,000. Our correspondent Muna Ba sent this report for Focus on Africa from Rabat.
Samira is a Moroccan activist. She has been campaigning for years for a law criminalizing violence against women. Her hard work has finally paid off.
We will not stop here. This law is an asset, but it has shortcomings that we have to work on.
Those shortcomings include a failure to provide a definition of domestic violence, and it does not explicitly criminalize marital rape.
We lacked appropriate tools to implement this law. In case of marital violence, it is difficult to provide proof, and we don't even have shelters for victims.
Violence against women, especially in public, has become a hot topic in Morocco after social media and rights groups highlighted shocking cases of sexual harassment. Huthaina Qarouri is a member of the parliamentary committee that drafted the law.
No law is perfect. Its effectiveness will depend on the approach adopted by the police and the judicial body. As it goes into effect, it is normal to discover some gaps, but they can be amended in the future.
In the street, the main talking point of the law is the part criminalizing sexual harassment in public spaces. A government survey in 2009 found that more than 60% of Moroccan women had been subjected to some kind of violence.
Women are often harassed in the street. This law is badly needed.
It is important to protect women against harassment. Women in public spaces suffer a lot from harassment.
I'm against this law because it is women now who harass men. And many women like to be harassed, but then they go and complain about it.
This new law is a significant step forward, but many critics here wonder to what extent it will help change the harsh reality in the lives of many Moroccan women. They say education and awareness are just as important to see real change. Muna Ba reporting from the Moroccan capital, Rabat.
Well, joining me now via Skype from Kenitra in Morocco is Sukaina Rashidi. She's a journalist at Inside Arabia. Sukaina, what's your reaction to this new law?
Well, I think the law is definitely required, and it's definitely brings new hope for women here in Morocco. But as your segment highlighted, there is a lot of things that it underlines that are missing here in Morocco. And one of the most important is the institutional support. But more important than that is actually the social support. Unfortunately, in many private spaces here in Morocco, in the nuclear family, many women might be ready or encouraged by the introduction of this law. However, their families might be the ones who are opposed to them actually coming out and accusing their abusers or actually reporting their abusers. So there is definitely a discrepancy between what the law is now allowing women to actually report and then what families and communities will allow these women and sometimes even men to report.
And of course, there's also the issue of cultural shift, isn't it? I mean, we heard in that report, the young man there saying, well, it's not our fault. The women like being harassed.
Well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, now we live in a really interesting time with globalization and global media. And unfortunately, in the private spaces, as I mentioned before, there's not really a lot of discussion about this at all, unless something very tragic like a rape or sexual harassment or violence or whatever occurs. And you know, in Arab context and in Morocco, there's no kind of sexual education, and there's not even a discussion amongst families about how women or men should view their bodies and how they should interact with each other. So they basically have to cobble together a sense of how they should interact with one another. And when they take it from music and movies, then this tends to be the result. Men learn, and women learn from music.
And of course, in countries like Morocco, as elsewhere on the continent, it's one thing to pass a law and have it obeyed in a city, but then when you take it to the rural areas, some people would never even have heard about this law.
Well, absolutely, and this is what I was discussing before about the institutional gaps, and then it's up to women's rights organizations and basically anybody concerned in this matter to go and educate the public, not only about what sexual harassment is or what sexual violence is, but also the legal basically tools at their disposal in order to be able to actually persecute or report their abusers and seek justice.
And just one final question, Sukaina, much further would you like the government to go with this law? What else could they add to it to ensure that it works?
Well, I think that they definitely have to define what domestic violence means in the framework of this law. But more importantly, you can't encourage women to go out of the social norms and report these crimes and then not provide them with some kind of support, whether it be financial or moral, in order to basically deal with the fallout of their actions or the reporting of these crimes.
Sukaina Rashidi from the journal Inside Arabia, thank you very much speaking to us there from Morocco. Let's go to Niger now, where our colleagues at BBC Afrique have been speaking with President Issoufou Mohamedou in Niamey. He spoke about security in his own country and in his capacity as the president of the G5 Sahel. He also spoke about the security threat in Burkina Faso, Chad, Mali, and Mauritania.
First of all, the G5 Sahel is not only dedicated to security. The G5 Sahel also considers the economic and social development of the five countries concerned. It is true that the Sahel faces today serious threats that I would qualify as strategic, insofar as these threats can jeopardize the life of the states. That do not prevent me from sleeping, but they are very worrying threats.
And with the attacks spreading in western Niger, northern Mali and Burkina Faso, the president denied that the response hadn't been strong enough.
The response is powerful, and we are engaged in this fight there too with allies. Do not forget that there is the Balkan force. We also have other allies who help us in intelligence gathering, but only it is a very great threat. For example, in the Middle East, it has been more than 3 years, more than 4 years that it lasts, while in the Middle East, in Syria, in Iraq, all the most powerful armies of the world were present.
And in terms of his own future, the president made it clear this will be his last term in office.
You journalists are a little curious. Every time I give an interview, I have to be asked the question about the third term. But why isn't there just that? There are so many subjects on which we can discuss. But since you ask me the question, I will satisfy your curiosity once again. No, I won't run for a third term. You are satisfied? I will not be changing the constitution. I will not be able to do it again.
As president of Niger, the Issoufou Mohamed. Let's take a quick look now at other stories making the headlines across Africa. The former Zambian vice president Neves Mumba has avoided prison after pleading that as a pastor, his congregation would suffer if he went to jail. He was found guilty of awarding a contract to a company to do electrical works at the official residence of the High Commissioner in Canada. The charges relate to when he served as ambassador to that country. Police in the Zimbabwean capital Harare have banned public gatherings because of an outbreak of cholera. The government declared a state of emergency on Tuesday following the deaths of more than 20 people in the past 10 days. The police says the outbreak is a threat to security. Algerian singer Rachid Taha has died of a heart attack at the age of 59. Taha, who lived in Paris, was famous for a style that mixed Algerian music with Western rock. He became hugely influential in the French music scene of the 1980s with his group Carte de Séjour. And elsewhere in the world, Apple has announced that it is launching its latest iPhone, Apple Watch, and a range of other products. It's thought that the world's first trillion-dollar company will build on past successes rather than introduce anything dramatically new.